In this part, we will take up the various methods by which asexual reproduction takes place. We already know asexual reproduction would involve only one organism or one parent. So number one, the first type of asexual reproduction, we will write it as fission. Fission basically means splitting. Now, in how many daughter cells or into how many daughter cells is the parent cell splitting would give us two types of fissions. One is called binary fission. And as the name tells us, one parent cell is going to divide into two daughter cells. This is seen in case of amoeba or paramecium-like organism. Such type of organisms which divide by binary fission are considered as immortal. Organisms dividing by binary fission are considered immortal. Now, why do we consider them as immortal? Let us take a small example. Say this is one amoeba. It is undergoing binary fission and it has produced two daughter cells. Two amoebae are produced. Now this young amoeba, it is going to grow to its normal size and again it's going to divide into two daughter amoebae. The same thing is going to happen with this one and this will also divide into two daughter amoebae. So where is the death? One cell has divided to produce daughter cells. The daughter cells are growing. They become adult. Again divide. They will grow. Again divide. So that is why organisms which divide by binary fission are considered as immortal. And here again we are talking about natural. If you take one amoeba and crush it, then obviously it's going to die. But naturally this is the normal process and that is why we call them immortal. This is binary fission, where one parent cell divides to produce two daughter cells. The second is known as multiple fission. Now, in multiple fission, one parent cell divides to produce many daughter cells. So, if this is one parent cell, what happens is, in the first case, the nuclear division takes place, only the nuclei divide. Each nucleus gets surrounded by a little cytoplasm and a membrane, and then the parent cell ruptures, releasing many daughter cells. And that is why we call it multiple fission. The example that we take up here is of Plasmodium, that is the malarial parasite. This shows this kind of multiple fission. So, the division is called simple fission. The second is known as budding. Bud is a tiny growth which is produced on the parent body. Now, where is this bud produced would be deciding the types. So, on the basis of that, there are two types of buddings. Exogenous and endogenous. Exogenous budding means that outgrowth, which we call the bud, is on the outer side of the parent body. We can take two examples here. One example is of yeast. Yeast is a unicellular fungus. When it has to produce a bud, it produces a tiny outgrowth which remains attached to the parent body till it grows to that stage where it can survive on its own. After that, the bud is going to detach. So you see this outgrowth on the outer side or outer surface of the body. The second example is Hydra. So in case of Hydra, the body is attached to a substratum. There are tentacles here. And we see a tiny outgrowth again, which resembles a baby or a daughter hydra. And this bud will again remain attached to the parent body till it attains that size where it can survive on its own. So in this case, we are seeing this bud or the outgrowth from the outside, that is external. Endogenous means when the bud grows inside the body. Bud is formed inside. This is seen in a freshwater sponge. So example is Spongula. Spongula is the only fresh water sponge. And the endogenous buds which are produced, they are called gemmules. So where are these gemmules and what exactly is the structure? Say this is a sponge. The sponges have porous body and there is an opening in the at the top, and say this is the body wall. These gemmules are on the inner side, and when the buds are fully formed, they are released outside in water. They come in contact with the substratum and grow into the body. Now if we draw a gemmule, then what exactly we see? We see a central mass of cells which will give rise to the body. So let us make all these cells here. These cells will form the body wall and all other cells. And this mass is surrounded by a gelatinous material so that it is prevented from drying. And here we see an opening. So this is the complete gelatinous material. In this gelatinous material are present some needle-like structures which are called the spicules. The spicules are the skeletal, endoskeletal structures which are found in sponges. So these are the spicules which protect. And this opening of the gemmule is known as micropyle. The cells which are present in the center, which make the mass, these are actually known as archaeocytes. So this is the structure of gemmule. How will this gemmule give rise to the sponge? The gemmules are released here in the water because they are inside. Many buds would be formed, many gemmules would be formed, and they would be released. When the gemmule is formed, when it is released, it is going to come and attach to the substratum through its micropyle. That means from this point, it will attach to the substratum. And these cells will come out and will form the body of the sponge. So this is how endogenous buds are formed. And the example is very important, that is Spongula, which is a freshwater sponge. So we have taken fission and budding here. Now let us take a few more types. The next type of asexual reproduction that we are talking of is by spore formation. Now the spores are of various types. We will take two important ones. One, zoospores. Zoospores are motile and they normally have flagella for movement. For example, in Chlamydomonas. In Chlamydomonas, the spores have biflagellae and they are able to freely swim in water. So they are motile and they are spores. But because they are motile, they are called zoospores. Example is Chlamydomonas. Then the next type of spores are called conidia. The example is Penicillium. Penicillium, the fungus. In Penicillium, when the spores are produced, they are produced in chain. So these are non-motile spores and they are always in chain. That means when the structure is formed, how do we make the structure? Say this is the penicillium. In penicillium, when we study this in detail in the kingdom fungi, we will see that here there are many such tiny spherical structures which are produced. These structures are produced from the lower part and upper end they get detached. So these structures, they are called conidia. They do not have any cilia or flagella, so they simply float with the water current. But they are always found in a chain, which is the characteristic feature of conidia. So two main categories, one zoospores, then conidia, which are non-motile. The next method of asexual reproduction is by fragmentation. Fragmentation means breaking down into pieces. This can be seen in Spirogyra. Spirogyra, which is a filamentous alga. So it is a thread-like algae, and these are the cells. These cells, they break, this thread breaks into fragments. So say this is one fragment which is formed, this is the other fragment which is formed, and each fragment would give rise to the complete organism or the the complete filament. So Spirogyra is one. In case of animals, we take the example of Planaria. Planaria is into platyhelminth phylum. And if this Planaria is cut into pieces, say for example, this is the body and it gets cut into pieces. That means these parts would be called fragments. Each part is capable of giving rise to a complete organism. Produces complete organism. Any part. That means each fragment is capable of giving rise to a complete organism. Though, actually, should it be considered as a method of reproduction or not? That's a question mark. Because here it gets cut into pieces or fragments accidentally. Spirogyra may get broken because of natural processes also. The fifth type is a special type of reproduction, asexual reproduction again, which is known as plasmotomy. Plasmotomy is seen in multinucleate protozoans. Multinucleate protozoans. The example can be of Opalina and Pilomyxa. These organisms naturally are multinucleate. That means one organism would have many nuclei. Normal division is first karyokinesis, that is, nucleus divides first, followed by cytoplasmic division. Here, it is cytokinesis first, followed by the nuclear division. So in this case, what's going to happen is cytokinesis first. Cytokinesis. That means this would divide into two smaller cells, and let us say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Say we have drawn 14 nuclei. Now, only this big cell is there. It divides into two. Nuclear division has not taken place. So say here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 nuclei come in this part. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 come into this. Now what is going to happen is each one is going to grow. And now the nuclear division will take place. That means now karyokinesis will take place. And this will become bigger, bigger with 14 nuclei each. So, this is binary fission. One parent cell is dividing into two daughter cells. But in a normal binary fission, because the division is mitosis, it is nucleus which divides first, followed by cytokinesis. Here, cytoplasm divides first, So whatever, and it is not necessary that every time equal number of nuclei would go into each daughter cell. Whatever the number is, the nuclei would divide later on to get the same nuclear number as that of the parent cell. So these are few more methods of asexual reproduction. Now in the next part, we will take up one more method, that is vegetative propagation in plants.